Bonjour, my friends. So, you wait to hear of D'Artagnan's adventures with the Three Musketeers. Well, there have been many, and from some I was not certain I would emerge alive. But perhaps you would like to know how I came to meet Athos, Porthos, and Aramis, and like them became a musketeer of King Louis XIII of France. It was on the first Monday of April in the year 1625 that I set out for Paris astride a gift from my father, a pony some 14 years of age. Unfortunately, he had no hair on his tail, and his coat was a yellow color, which, by the way, was the cause of my first duel. When I paused to rest at an inn, a gentleman with a scar on his cheek angered me when he laughed at my pony. So I challenged him to a duel. But I am afraid I was not yet skilled as a swordsman. When I awoke in my room at the inn, there was a cut on my forehead, and the gentleman with the scar was gone. And with him, the letter of introduction which my father had given to me for Monsieur de Treville, Captain of the Musketeers. When I arrived in Paris and explained to Monsieur de Treville what had happened at the inn, he seemed to know the man with the scar and warned me never again to engage him in a duel. He also informed me that I must serve an apprenticeship in a lesser company of guards before I would be allowed to enter the ranks of the musketeers. As I left his chambers, I spied the gentleman with the scar going through the door leading to the street. In spite of Monsieur de Treville's warning, I hurried after the man who had stolen my letter, hoping to catch him and demand its return. A musketeer in a full cape stood at the foot of the steps. As I attempted to pass him, a sudden gust of wind blew out the cape, and I found myself wrapped up in it.
And what wild creature have I trapped that struggles so? A rabbit? A deer? Perhaps a ferocious pig, eh?
I beg of you, monsieur, let me go.
In a moment, my young gentleman who wriggles like an eel. Do you make it a habit to bump into people like this?
I am sorry, but I was running after someone and I...
And do you not look when you run?
Yes, I look when I run. And I see what others do not see.
Your tongue is sharp, my young friend.
You will feel the sharpness of my rapier as well as my tongue if you do not let me pass.
You would challenge a musketeer?
If that is your pleasure. But at the moment, I am otherwise occupied.
Come back! Come back and defend yourself.
Later, when my mission is completed.
At 1 o'clock, then. Convent of the Carmelites.
At 1 o'clock. Leaving the angry musketeer behind me, I rushed down the street. But this was not a day of luck for me. Not only had the mysterious stranger disappeared, but I had also bumped into two other musketeers and challenged them to a duel also. For me, there was but one consolation. If I was to be killed, it would be by a musketeer. So it was that at the hour of one, I waited on the uncultivated patch of ground which surrounded the convent of the Carmelites. Before the clock had finished its chiming, I saw three figures approaching, the three musketeers whom I had angered.
Ah, monsieur, I see you are on time to die.
For whatever reason, monsieur, I am always on time.
You have brought no seconds?
Having arrived but yesterday in Paris, I know no one.
You wish to withdraw, then?
D'Artagnan never withdraws.
D'Artagnan, is it? Permit me. I am Porthos.
Monsieur?
And this is Athos.
Monsieur Athos. Monsieur.
And Aramis.
Monsieur Aramis?
Monsieur.
And now that we are properly introduced, let me offer my apologies.
Apologies?
Do not misunderstand, gentlemen. I apologize only because I shall not be able to pay my debt to all three of you. If I first duel with you, Monsieur Porthos, you will undoubtedly kill me, and the challenge of Monsieur Athos and Aramis will go unanswered. So, gentlemen, I repeat, forgive me, but for that only. Now, en garde, Monsieur Porthos.
The sun is quite hot. You will permit me to remove my cape?
As you wish.
You wish to remove your doublet?
No, monsieur.
Eh bien. En garde. Your rapier does well in your hand.
I was taught by my father.
An excellent teacher. One moment, D'Artagnan.
Why do you lower your rapier?
Look, they're coming this way. The guards of Cardinal Richelieu. They come to arrest us for dueling. Sheathe your sword and go while there's yet time. We three will remain to fight them.
A contradiction, Monsieur Porthos. Four will remain.
But you are not one of us.
That is true, but though I have not the uniform, I have the spirit. I am a musketeer at heart.
You're a brave lad, D'Artagnan. So be it. Athos, Aramis, draw your swords. All for one, and one for all.
All for one, and one for all.
So we stood back to back, the Three Musketeers and I, and crossed our swords with those of Richelieu's guards. I perhaps was not as skillful as the others, but my father had taught me well. When the fighting was done, I had accounted for one of the three who had been wounded. So began my apprenticeship in the Musketeers and my friendship with Athos, Porthos, and Aramis. It was not long after this encounter with Richelieu's guards that we four were involved in the affair of the Queen's diamonds. Although Louis XIII ruled France with his Queen Anne of Austria, the real power was Cardinal Richelieu, who scorned the king's weakness and plotted to turn him against Queen Anne because of her ties with England and her homeland, Austria. Richelieu's spies were everywhere, and everyone was watched. One who was especially watched was Constance Bonacieux, the wife of my landlord, whose room was below mine. Because of a loose board in the floor, it was possible for me to hear any conversation in the room below. One day I heard Madame Constance cry for help when two of Richelieu's agents broke into the Bonacieux room and attempted to seize her. I dashed to the Bonacieux's room, and when I had driven out the intruders, I begged her to tell me what information they sought from her. She refused, saying it would be too dangerous for me to know. I was not to learn for some time the secret which she feared to tell me, or of the plot between Richelieu and his agent, Monsieur de Rochefort, who, I discovered, was a mysterious stranger with a scarred face who had stolen my letter to Monsieur de Treville. Not long after I had come to the aid of Madame Constance, I was later to learn that Rochefort and Richelieu met in the Cardinal's chambers, and their plot was conceived.
It is true, Eminence. The Queen and the English Duke of Buckingham have been meeting in secret.
You learned this from Madame Bonacieux?
No. Unfortunately, my men were set upon by the young Gascon, D'Artagnan, before she could be made to speak. But Madame de Lannoy, one of the Queen's ladies, who is entirely at the service of your Eminence, came to me with a report of what she had seen.
Go on.
Last evening, as she emerged from the Louvre, she heard the whinnying of a horse at a side entrance. Curious, she investigated, keeping discreetly in the shadows. Two figures were shielded by a carriage, but she recognized their voices.
The Queen and Buckingham?
Yes. Madame de Lannoy heard the Duke tell Her Majesty that he had reached the Louvre, a previously arranged meeting place, without being seen. He had come to get information from Her Majesty regarding her plans to have Your Eminence removed from office.
To have me... Go on, de Rochefort.
Madame de Lannoy then heard Her Majesty tell the Duke that she was writing a letter to the King of Spain regarding the plan. When word had been brought to her that he, the Duke, waited for her in the Louvre.
Was that all that passed between them?
No. Her Majesty urged the Duke to leave France and to return to London before he was discovered. Then Madame de Lannoy saw the Queen take a small rosewood casket from beneath a cape and give it to the Duke as a gift of gratitude for his friendship and the dangers he had risked on her behalf.
Did Madame de Lannoy know what was in the cask?
The 12 diamond clips which the King gave to the Queen on her recent birthday.
The King's diamonds.
There was one more thing.
More?
As the Duke accepted the diamonds from Her Majesty, he promised to wear them to the first ball he would attend on his return to London.
Excellent, excellent. I shall dispatch a letter to my agent, Milady de Winter, in London without delay, so that it may reach there before Buckingham arrives. I shall write... Yes, I have it. Milady, be present at the first ball to which the Duke of Buckingham goes. He will wear 12 diamond clips in his doublet. Manage to secure 2 of them. As soon as they are in your possession, send word to me. So much for Buckingham. Now I shall have word reached the King that correspondence has passed between the Queen and Buckingham plotting the King's overthrow.
Such correspondence exists.
Look not so shocked, de Rochefort. It is part of my plan to make Louis suspect the Queen of treason, and then to convince him he should apologize to her when he learns his suspicions were false.
I do not understand.
You will, my dear de Rochefort. You will. Majesty?
Yes, Richelieu. Word was recently brought to me that there had been a secret correspondence between Her Majesty and Lord Buckingham. When the Chancellor inquired of Her Majesty if such correspondence did exist, he returned with a letter.
From Lord Buckingham?
No. It was a letter to the King of Spain containing a plan of attack which would result in your dismissal.
Oh, you see to what lengths my enemies would go, Majesty. They would undoubtedly declare war unless I were relieved of my office. Before I would see war come to France, I would retire as cardinal. I grow old and my work at court is finished.
No, you shall not retire. No. All who were mentioned in the letter will be punished, even the Queen.
Oh, you would punish Her Majesty? I would not have it on my conscience that she should suffer because of me. Since the letter was intercepted and no harm has been done, may I suggest, if you were to make a gesture to show Her Majesty that your suspicions were ill-founded.
What sort of a gesture?
You might do something which would please her. A ball. You know her love of dancing, and it would give her an opportunity to wear the diamonds which you gave her for her birthday, and which she has not yet had the opportunity to wear.
An excellent idea, Richelieu. Excellent. When would you suggest the ball be given?
2 weeks' time should be sufficient to take care of everything.
When the ball was announced, I learned of Richelieu's plot. Madame Constance told me everything.
Someone must go to London with all haste, Monsieur D'Artagnan. Before 14 days have passed, the casket of 12 diamonds must be returned to Paris. If Her Majesty does not wear them to the ball, all will be lost.
Why have you come to me? Surely your husband.
I have discovered he is loyal to the cardinal. You are the only one who can do this.
I cannot accomplish this mission alone. For the agents of the cardinal will undoubtedly attempt to stop anyone who leaves France. But I will ask my friends Athos, Porthos, and Aramis. They share my loyalty to the Queen.
God go with you, Monsieur D'Artagnan.
At 2 a.m, the Three Musketeers and I left Paris. All night we rode, and near 8 a.m, we stopped at the inn in Chantilly. As we sat at breakfast, a stranger proposed a toast to Richelieu. Porthos agreed, if the stranger would drink to the king. The stranger replied that he knew no other king than Richelieu, and drew his sword. We shouted to Porthos to dispatch him as soon as possible and join up with us, and then we were on our way. At Beauvais, we waited 2 hours, but when Porthos did not appear, we continued. We were hardly out of sight of Beauvais when we were trapped in an ambush. Aramis received a shoulder wound, but we were able to escape from the ambush. For 2 hours, we galloped toward Calais. But at Crèvecoeur, Aramis, faint from the loss of blood, could go no farther. So it was only Athos and I who spurred on our horses. At midnight, we reached the inn at Amiens, where we intended to rest until daylight. But at 4 o'clock, we heard a great noise in the stable. When we rushed down to see what it was, 4 men, armed to the teeth, plunged out of the shadows at us. As Athos held them off, I took to my horse. Though 4 of us had set out from Paris, it was only I who sped along the last remaining miles to Calais. But when I reached Calais, one more obstacle lay before me. No one could leave France without a permit signed by Richelieu. After some persuasion, aided greatly by my sword, I convinced a gentleman that I should take his permit and his place for the boat trip across the Channel. When I finally reached the Duke of Buckingham's castle in London, I explained to him the danger in which the Queen had placed herself by her indiscretion in giving him the diamonds and the urgent need for returning them to her without delay. But when the Duke gave me the little rosewood casket, he discovered there were only 10 diamonds. 2 were missing. They had to be replaced before I returned to Paris, and time was getting short. Wasting no time, the Duke summoned his jeweler and instructed him to make 2 diamonds like the others. Within 2 days, I was on my way back to France with a box containing 12 perfectly matched diamonds. Once back in Paris, I hurried toward the Hotel de Ville, where the ball was even then in progress. I prayed that I would be in time. I would have prayed harder had I known that as I neared the hotel, Richelieu was engaged in conversation with the king.
A most magnificent ball, Majesty.
Most magnificent.
Her Majesty has not yet arrived.
She's sent word she's been delayed.
No doubt she wishes to appear at her best. I suggest, Majesty, that when the Queen arrives, you give her these.
Diamonds? What do they mean?
Nothing, Majesty. But if she should be wearing the diamonds you gave her, I suggest that you count them. If there are only 10, ask her who could have taken these two.
I do not understand what...
I beg your forgiveness, Louis, but I had some difficulty with my wig. Your Eminence?
Your Majesty.
I see you wear the diamonds, madam. But are there not 2 missing?
2 missing? Why, no, my lord. As you can see, I wear all 12.
So you do, madam. Richelieu, what does this mean?
It means that I wish to present these 2 diamonds to a most beautiful and clever queen.
I am most touched by your generosity, Your Eminence. Shall we dance, Louis?
So it was that Cardinal Richelieu's plot was thwarted, and the queen was saved. I hasten to add that Athos, Porthos, and Aramis returned safely to Paris, a few more souvenirs of combat added to their collection, and in time I was accepted as a musketeer. Perhaps one day I shall tell you of another adventure of the musketeers, for we had many. And through them all, we did not forget the pledge we made when first we met.
All for one, and one for all!